Alright, well everyone, I didn't have notes tonight, as you can imagine. I've been kind of busy the last few weeks, and so I have notes, but I did not type them up and to pass them out to you. We're going to talk about something which is really something I've been looking forward to, frankly, since I started this series almost 2 months ago now. I've walked through the Apostles' Creed, we get to this line, and I think this is the line where, for us, this is where it all comes together, right? We could start, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born or conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He rose again on the third day. He ascended into heaven, where he sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins. Next week, we'll talk about the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. I'm excited about that one too. But forgiveness of sins. Why does it matter that there's a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? It's so we can get to this point, brothers and sisters, the forgiveness of sins. And so as we talk about what this means for us tonight, how it's applied to us, we're going to kind of look at three facets of forgiveness of sins. First, we're going to look at the God who forgives. Second, we're going to see the means of forgiveness. And finally, we're going to see how we are a forgiven and forgiving people. So we're going to look at the God who forgives, the means of forgiveness, and finally, how we are a forgiven and forgiving people. Recently, I had a friend who is a couple years older than I am. We went to church together in Jackson, Tennessee, very dear father, and I mean, friends with the whole family. I'm particularly close to the husband and father. And, you know, like a lot of college graduates today, he graduated with a lot of debt. Debt that was so great that he and his wife couldn't go on the mission field. That's the number one preventing thing for young adults going on the mission field who feel called today is student debt. I want you to think about that. They had too much debt. They couldn't go. And so he was a teacher, taught public school, and for years, after teaching for 6 or 7 years, started a PhD program, which was really hard on his family. He struggled in his faith some during that time because he lost a close friend. But he made it through that. And you might have heard, you know, student debt's a big topic in the news today. But one of the things that came out a year or two ago is that there was a program to forgive student debt for public servants, particularly teachers. And it was kind of like if they fudged anywhere in their paperwork, here's the deal. You have student debt, but if you teach for 10 years, we'll write the whole thing off. And what they were finding is that, you know, like only 2% of the people who applied for that got it. But it was supposed to be the promise that they all got when they signed up to go to school. So, you know, he was one of the people where it was kind of like they weren't acknowledging his public service in that regard. And so he finished his PhD a year ago and kept teaching. And, you know, that debt hampered a lot of the decisions he made. They lived in a smaller house. They had to, you know, buy more modest vehicles as their family grew. They, you know, they weren't living high on the hog by any stretch, but it really prevented them from doing some things. Well, you know, he applied. The presidential administration realized, hey, this plan, we didn't deliver on the promise. We got to fix it. And so he applied. And not only was the college debt forgiven from his undergraduate days, but they went ahead and wrote off the entire bill, including his PhD debt. I mean, this is like $60,000 or $70,000 in debt. And it just disappeared. And you know what that did to him and his family? It suddenly provided freedom. The way the debt that was counted against them, he was free. Suddenly, they didn't have to stay in the small house anymore. He didn't have to stay in a low-paying job so he could get that forgiveness. It opened up opportunities for him, and they've enjoyed that blessing. There's the power of forgiveness. There's a debt that is counted against you. Colossians chapter 2 says it this way, the debt that stood against us with its legal demands is nailed. It's set aside at the cross of Jesus Christ. The debt of our sin, that is. But the only way we could be forgiven at all is if we had a God who forgives, right? There is not we could talk about and wax eloquent about the attributes of God all day long. And I've heard it sometimes broken up into two different categories. We're going to talk about God's greatness attributes. He is powerful. He is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. That means he's all-knowing, all-powerful, everywhere at all times. We could talk about that there is no one like him. And then there's goodness attributes. The fact that he is kind and merciful and gracious, how he reveals himself to us. Right, there are some people who really, really relish the fact that God is all-powerful. They make a big deal about that. They neglect the goodness. We can't forget that. We got to hold both of them together. So we come back to this definition that God, as he describes himself in Exodus 34, 6 and 7, which I've made much of because I think the Bible makes much of it. God passed before Moses and said, the Lord, Yahweh, a God, merciful, that's number one, merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love to thousands, forgiving. There we go. That's how God describes himself, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. The verb there in the Hebrew is actually the verb for carrying. I'm going to carry their sin. I'm going to carry their burdens. So, you know, whenever we think about sin, sometimes we think of forgive and forget. And we know God says he puts our sin as far away from us as the east is from the west. So far is our sin from God whenever he forgives us. However, it's because God has chosen to carry that sin. There was a theologian in the 7th century called Isaac the Syrian. And he said, it's almost as if we take our sin like a handful of sand and we cast it into the ocean. That's what it's like whenever we cast our sin upon the Lord. It doesn't matter how much sand we throw at the ocean. We're not going to fill the ocean because the mercy is so great, so wonderful. And not only has this God revealed himself to be a God who forgives, this I think applies to how we read the book of Leviticus. Again, I've said before, I've done a whole lesson on this before, because Leviticus is sometimes, you know, you start your Bible reading plan January 1st for the year. You go through Genesis, it's great. Creation, the flood, Abraham, all the drama that goes with Abraham's family. I mean, if you like soap operas, you've got to love the book of Genesis, because it is a soap. Get to the book of Exodus, it's awesome, deliverance, plagues, the mountain. And then they get to the mountain, and you kind of have a little bit of a hiccup. There's a lot of instructions for the temple, the tabernacle. You get through, and then you get to Leviticus. And there's page after page, chapter after chapter of all these, what's called just rules, you know. Here's this one type of sacrifice, and if you're a priest, you bring this type of sacrifice. If you're a man, you bring this type of sacrifice. If you're a woman, you need to bring this type of sacrifice. And that's actually just one category because there's 7 categories. But you know what's at the very center of the book of Leviticus, which is at the very center of the Pentateuch, the Torah, the first 5 books of the Bible? It's Leviticus chapters 16 and 17, which is the chapter of the Day of Atonement. Yeah, there's all these complex regulations that God has certain expectations of his people, but right there at the middle, what all these sacrifices enable the people to have is reconciliation with God. They come on the Day of Atonement one time a year. The whole nation gathers. The priest, before he even puts his clothes on, he cleanses his clothes. Then he cleanses himself. Before he can go stand on behalf of the people, he's got to be pure. And then he goes and he gets 2 goats. And he puts his hands on the goats and he confesses the sins of the people. And they take one of the goats like they normally would take sacrifices, and they sacrifice the goat before the Lord. They sprinkle that blood on the Ark of the Covenant. The one time a year the priest could go in to the Ark of the Covenant, by the way. And then they would take the other goat and they would take him and send him far out in the wilderness. Someone's job was to take him out and just to let him go. I heard someone describe it this way. It's almost as if God had given us forgiveness. If there were 2 balloons, filled with helium, one he decided to just let go, fly high into the sky, so far you can't ever see it again. And the other one, he takes a pin and he just pops it. And that's how God carries our sins. It's no longer counted against us. So Leviticus, for all the complicated parts of it that can confuse us and puzzle us, and why is there so much blood and sacrifice, it's so that we can be forgiven. Take the calf to the priest, sacrifice it this way, and his sins will be forgiven. And God's ideal society, it's a society where there is forgiveness. And that's important. Remember, we talked about this on Sunday, Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, you, O Israel, are not consumed. It's a good thing that God doesn't change, because it means that that mercy that lies at his very heart is still there. So that whenever the people have failed again and again and again and again, and God has made a covenant with them, and they just doesn't seem to matter anymore, and he makes a promise, I will give you a new covenant. We've gone to that passage a lot in my time as your pastor. Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through 34. And here's the promise at the end of that passage. I don't have my Bible, but just because I looked at it earlier, I know what it says. And I will forgive them. I will forgive them their sins, and I will remember their iniquity no more. Wow. Whenever God forgives our iniquity, our transgression, and our sin, remember those are three, you know, synonyms we might use, but they all mean different things. Iniquity is, it's a twistedness. I would even call it, that's kind of the wickedness we read of in the Bible. It's someone who takes God's law, it takes God's word, and they twist it to mean something else. They warp it away from God's intention. Transgression is, namely, that we transgress something. Here's a line, and I've crossed it. I've crossed the barrier for what God told me not to do. And then sin. That's the general catch-all term we normally use, but it means specifically to fall short. Right? For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's giving us that definition. It's almost like, you know, if an archer, you know, he could be a good target. You know, I don't know how far archers shoot their bows. Let's say 200 yards, and then they pull it back and it goes, hits the target. Okay, that's a long distance. But if the archer had his bow and he paused and he pulled the string and he decided to go up and he's going to aim for the sun, even if that arrow goes a quarter mile into the sky, sun's 93 million miles away. It falls short. It's not going to make it there. And so we fall short of God's standard, but God says that he forgives all of those things. And in the new covenant, there's a new qualitative level of forgiveness that we receive. You can read the book of Hebrews. It's really good about that. There's a once-for-all sacrifice for our sins in Jesus. And that's the next thing I want to talk about. We have a God who forgives. Again, read the book of Judges. Read the book of 1 Kings, and you're amazed that God would stick with this hard-hearted people, set hell-bent on wickedness, disregarding God's law. The kings, the rulers, they don't seem to give much mind to God, but he still is their God. And he calls them back. He brings them back to the land from their exile, ultimately sending his son. How are we forgiven? Well, we know the line from the Bible, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. God sent his own son, Jesus Christ, in the fullness of time to live for us, to die for us, to rise again. And really what the Bible says is that a couple things about Jesus. Number one is that he was forgiving. You know, it's interesting in Mark chapter 2, Jesus is teaching in a house, and the friends come with the friend who is paralyzed, and they couldn't get to Jesus. So what do? They climb up on the roof, they tear the roof open, lower their friend down. Pretty audacious. And Jesus heals the man. Well, let's see how it goes. I'm losing a detail on the story real fast. It'll take me just a second to get there. Okay. So it says when Jesus, they whenever Jesus saw their faith, Mark 2:5, he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." They bring him to Jesus so that he can heal his paralysis. Jesus gives him salvation. And some of the scribes are saying, why does he speak like this? He's blaspheming. No one can forgive but God alone. And then Jesus says, okay, well, if you want to know if I have authority on earth to forgive sins, I tell you, hey, take up your bed, walk, go home. The healing of the paralytic is proof that Jesus has authority to forgive sins. And his death and resurrection accomplished this for us. Again, his atoning death, which we would read in line with the suffering servant of Isaiah 52 and 53, we're told that this is where we were forgiven. Whenever he gives in the Gospel of Matthew, he gives them the Lord's Supper for the first time. He says, this is my body broken for you, my blood which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. My blood is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Acts chapter 5, verse 31. Another instance where Peter's preaching the gospel, preaching the good news. And we're told, he says, he was exalted to the right hand for your forgiveness. exalted to the right hand of the Lord for your forgiveness. So we're forgiven because of what Jesus Christ has done. And we're also forgiven because we believe. And this is, we might say, how the means of forgiveness. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Peter's preached his sermon and the people are saying, "Then what shall we do to be saved?" And he says, "Repent and believe for the forgiveness of your sins." Right? Repentance, we read that, and there's a little book by the Puritan Thomas Watson. What the Puritans are good at, sometimes this makes you kind of tired, I'll be honest. But one of the things they're good at is they're taking a small idea in the Bible and just excavating it to pieces. And again, sometimes you like, you know, is this just pieces that we put together? But I think this book, the little book by Thomas Watson, The Doctrine of Repentance, how do we know true repentance, right? It's more than just contrition. That's one of the first things we have to realize. Repentance isn't just, I feel bad for what I did. That's kind of step one. It's genuine sorrow and brokenness that you have sinned and offended God. You've sinned against other people. But repentance is involved. What's involved in that, you have contrition. Part of that is confession. We name our sin out loud. I need to ask your forgiveness. For what? Why am I forgiving you? What wrong have you done? If it's forgiven us, sometimes they're confessing their sin to the Lord. We can pronounce the grace to them that they are forgiven. They confess their sins, and then the repentance is turning away. Right? It's, I think that, and this is why the book, The Doctrine of Repentance, was written. Sometimes people say, "Well, I've confessed my sins. What else do I need to do?" We need to stop sinning. But nevertheless, we repent of our sins. We turn away. Again, we understand we're going to fail. The Bible tells us that. But we fail and we receive. We repent of our sins. We confess our sins. I want to read for just a moment Psalm 32. But I'll get to that in just a minute. So yeah, we believe and we repent, and that's where we are forgiven. We can have reconciliation with the Lord. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Our wrongs are not held against us by the Lord. So how do we live this out in our life? How do we apply it to our lives daily? I want to go to two Psalms. They're probably very familiar to you. The first, again, I think the way that we live a life of forgiveness is we continue in repentance. We continue in confession. Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For while I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all my day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Here's the turn. But I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, if I will confess my sin, my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. While he covered his sin, he did not enjoy forgiveness. But whenever he confessed his sin, God covered him. God atoned for his sin. So we can confess our sin to the Lord. We don't hide it. Again, God's first impulse for us is mercy. So we have nothing to hide. If he's given us forgiveness, sometimes I think we're worried if we let the light on it, then he's going to really strike back. Well, he already knows. The best thing to do is to settle your account with the Lord and confess it. Be right. Be made in right standing with him. And the second, again, is just repentance. Again, Psalm 51, the very famous psalm of confession. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. There's an acknowledgement that the only way he's going to receive forgiveness, David, after he sinned against Bathsheba, sinned against her husband, had him murdered in a conspiracy, the only way he can receive forgiveness is if the Lord cleanses him. And this is good news. Well, that's why we sing in our hymn, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus, a pardon receives. And we do rejoice in the salvation of the wicked. Sometimes we get really happy. And again, I think the Bible does put some language to this whenever we see the wicked judged. But we're even more joy in heaven when the sinner repents, we're told. Luke chapter 15. We have these portraits of forgiveness, like the father of the prodigal son, whose son has squandered his wealth, wished him dead, And now comes crawling back, and the father is only excited and joyful that his son, who was dead, is now alive, who was lost, is found. We don't want to have the hard heart of the older brother who says, no, dad might have forgiven you, but not me. I'm bitter because you were forgiven much, even though I did nothing wrong. At least that's what the perspective of the brother. But as we are forgiven and forgiving, there's always this line that I think is, it should really shake us if we, when we're praying it at the end of the Lord's Prayer. We, in the Lord's Prayer, we have the line, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us the things that we owe as we forgive the people who owe us things. And then, you know, for thine is the kingdom and power and glory forever and ever. Amen. And then the next line Jesus says, and if you forgive others, your sins will be forgiven. If you do not forgive others, your sins will not be forgiven. That's kind of striking. And then he adds more potency to that in Matthew 18. Peter comes to him, Lord, if my brother sins against me, how many times shall I forgive him? Seven? Maybe 77? 70 times? Seven. I mean, that's a lot, Jesus. And Jesus tells a parable. It was a rich king. Somebody owed him a lot of money. 10,000 talents. For context, that is in the hundreds of billions of dollars today. The king came to get his money back. I couldn't pay. So the king is going to put him in prison. Take his family. Sell his family into slavery. That's what you would do if you couldn't pay your debts back then. Your children were on the bargaining table. It's a good thing. You know, you might criticize the bankruptcy system today, but at least make sure you can't do that. He asks for mercy, and he's given mercy. He's forgiven 10,000 talents. 20,000 years worth of wages he's forgiven. Well, then he goes and finds someone who owes him 100 days worth of wages, 100 denarii. This is the servant now. The forgiven servant goes and he finds someone who owes him 100, and he demands the payment. He can't pay. He starts choking him and beating him. And the other servants are like, whoa, you mean the guy who just was forgiven $200 billion is beating up on the guy who owes him $20,000? We're going to go tell the king. And the king takes the first one back and he throws him in prison. Now, and I'm not here to have anyone question their salvation in the Lord. All that to say that what the implication is, Jesus says the same thing. If you forgive others their sins, you will be forgiven yours. If you do not, your sins will not be forgiven. The Bible expects that if we have been forgiven in the Lord, we need to forgive others. And the thing that we learn from that parable is that forgiveness for us has a cost. If someone owes you a debt and you release them that debt, you're going to lose something. You're not going to get the full payment back. We don't just want to live in this pie-in-the-sky reality of, well, let's just live with no offense. No, real offense happens. And we do want to be careful whenever we talk to people who are the victims of crime, who are sometimes forgiveness is weaponized against them. This happens a lot in cases of abuse and sexual abuse. Well, you know, as soon as someone confesses that they committed sexual sin or abuse, the person who was wronged is immediately told, well, you got to forgive them. And rather than protect that person and make sure they're well, they're said, no, you need to go remedy things. And again, I think that is a weaponization of forgiveness. We don't want to do that. I'm not saying that forgiveness should not be offered, but I'm saying they're so concerned to get to the reconciliation piece, they didn't even check to make sure the person was okay. But I think what it means for us is that we need to keep short accounts. I know people who squabble and get, you know, squabble over petty things, middle school drama stuff, but these are adults. And sometimes it's one person who holds a grudge, sometimes they both hold a grudge, and they can't get over little things, petty disagreements. God, the Bible does call us to keep short accounts, and that's just personal stuff. That's not even real wrong, right? The real wrong is what do you do when someone has slandered you? What do you do whenever someone borrows money from you and they can't pay you back? What do you do whenever someone does things that put things in your way to prevent you from flourishing? They make sure you can't get that promotion. They make sure you can't get that position that would benefit you and your family. What do you do? Well, the Bible says we are to forgive them. I think there's a way the Psalms sometimes say that, or Proverbs at least, that's, you know, if you forgive them and they're still stubborn, it's heaping coals on their head, but you still take the high road. Again, we keep short accounts. We are forgiven. We must remember what the Lord has forgiven us of. And again, this is the heart of our salvation, the fact that we get to know God and have a relationship with Him. And so, forgiveness is, it's a wonderful thing. And again, whenever we forgive somebody, we've given them something that they could have never bought, they could have never earned. But it comes just as God has given it to us from the position of grace. And we're not trying to be, make other people debtors to us in grace. That's not it. We just give freely. We've been freely forgiven. We need to freely forgive other people. So we have a God who forgives, Father, Son, and Spirit. They work together in concert for our salvation. God, we are the means of our forgiveness is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ and our faith and repentance. And we live lives as forgiven sinners who are forgiving others. We confess our sins. We continue to forgive. We understand every day that we're forgiven people. And that changes how we live. But we also need to continue to forgive others. Not just saying, well, I forgive him, but I'm not going to talk to him anymore. No, if we've forgiven someone, we need to see if there's a way which we can be reconciled. It's incumbent upon us as Christians to do so. So this is the joy that we have in the Lord. Next week, we're going to talk about, again, the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. What does it mean to live with God for eternity? I'll have some answers. There's other things I won't have answers to, but we can point to the Lord and rejoice in our salvation together. So let me say a word of prayer and we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, I pray. We're so thankful for the forgiveness that you've given us in Jesus, your Son, a forgiveness that we don't deserve, but which you have given to us freely at your own cost, Father. Father, we ask that you would help us to enjoy that forgiveness, to never take it for granted, and that we would also, in turn, forgive others. Help us to be agents of reconciliation and peace. God, as we go forward from this day, keep us cool in the hot weather and bring us together again, once again this Sunday. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Amen. Amen.